Hi there, I'm Melissa Giramonte. I am the founder and editor of a site called The Televixen, and I also launched in the past year and a half a podcast called Femme TV, which is a women in television podcast. So being asked to moderate this panel is kind of a dream job. So before, you've already met Vanessa. This is Vanessa Piazza, in case you didn't catch that. I'm going to bring up the other panelists now too. We've got Zoe Palmer. And then we've got Vanessa Matsui. And finally, Lara Azzabardi. So while everyone is getting settled in, I was thinking that each one of the women on the panel could introduce what it is that they do in the industry and maybe tease a little project that they're working on at the moment.
Hi. Hello. I'm Lara Azzabardi. I am a writer-director. I co-created a show called Backstage for Family Channel and Disney and Netflix. But most recently, I've been writing and producing on Mary Kill's People. And I am developing a few new one-hour shows, so we'll see what happens.
And I'm Vanessa Piazza. I am a producer. I have my own production company called Piazza Entertainment. I'm working on lots of cool stuff in development right now. I've actually got a few projects with Lara that I'm really excited to be working with her again. I was the executive producer of Lost Girl, which I had the pleasure of working with all these ladies on at some point in time. Lara was a writer and an on-set producer. Vanessa played an awesome Oracle, and Zoe was Dr. Lauren, who had a lot, massive fan base. And this is Zoe.
Hi. I was an actor. I am an actor still, which is good. And I was on Lost Girl in Dark Matter with Vanessa.
Oh, right.
And
we also did Dark Matter.
Hey, I'm Vanessa Matsui. I'm an actress, mostly. I was on Lost Girl for a couple seasons. And
you were on season, like,
every
season.
One? Was it every season? And I'm on The Girlfriend Experience. And I've recently created a web series called Ghost BFF, which is amazing.
No, it is. I think it's really
cool.
Thank you.
Yeah. It's going to launch probably at the end of February, but dates are to be determined still, but I'll hopefully have some news soon.
So I was hoping I could get an idea from all of you. If you could touch on your experience as a woman in the industry and perhaps any challenges you may have faced along the way, and this is open to the entire panel. Any specific stories you want to share or just overall?
I
start off hard and get easier from there.
His favorite color? I like red.
Well, so I started off, I literally grew up in the industry. My father is a director, and so I grew up on sets watching him. And then when I was in high school, I was an AD in my summer, so I worked as an AD. And that was one of, in terms of being a woman, I mean, I've been in, I would say 90% of the rooms I've been in have been all men, except for me, except for when I ran a room, and even Vanessa's room at Lost Girl was a lot of women. But mainly, as an AD, that, as a woman, was a very tough job to navigate. Just being with the crew, I was quite young. It was very hard. But those experiences, I don't want to go too much into it. But I as a woman in a writer's room where I have been the only woman many, many times, it's just tough. And I think I don't know what your question was. I can talk forever about all this. So what specifically am I answering?
Just in general, what your experience has been like.
It's tough. tough, and you just learn from every experience. And I feel like, you know, what's going on, a lot of the men that I've worked with don't really know that it was an inappropriate environment. And I also feel like I've been, I just want to be one of the boys a lot of the time, and so you kind of like suck it up. But it's just tough. And I feel like things are going to change. I hope they are. I haven't experienced it yet, so I'm hoping. I mean, other than my own room, when it was my room, it was lots of women, and the room I was just in now, Mary Kills People, we were all women, and that was amazing.
Mary killed all the men.
Anyway, there's my...
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, it's obviously such an interesting subject, and coming from like the producer side of it, I feel like part of my job has always been to make sure that I am empowering women, and I'm sort of on the other side of it where, you know, I'm doing a lot of the hiring, and so it's about me making those active choices and fighting against networks who a lot of the time just want to make the safe choices, and a lot of the time in the past that has been hiring, you know, the male showrunner that's been around forever, and I've, you know, worked really hard throughout my career to make sure that I've hired women, and like, not just because they're women, because they're awesome writers, and you know, most of the rooms that I, you know, that have been like all the showrunners for most of my shows have been predominantly run by women, and have been super successful. But there is this sort of underlying tone in the industry, even though it is a very liberal industry. Like we're much more fortunate than like the finance industry or something like that, where, you know, people, it's very different, where, you know, being gay would be awful. Like in our industry, that stuff like that's celebrated, and, you know, but there's still a lot of hurdles we have to cross. I mean, female directors have a really tough time, and as you said, ADs. A friend of mine and a director that we all have worked with, Mirzi Almas, who was actually going to come tonight, who's like on fire right now doing tons of huge US shows, she was an AD for 20 years. So an AD is an assistant director, if you don't know what that means, and essentially you're doing all the grunt work. You're dealing with all the shit. And Mirzi was an AD for, I think, almost like 22 years, and she really wanted to move into directing, and she just couldn't get that break. And a lot of it was because she was a woman, and people just couldn't trust her to do that job. And once she was, even when she, like, I hired her on Lost Girl, and she was phenomenal. She was the most prepared director I've ever worked with, and she had great ideas. She was super creative, but the crew sometimes, even, you know, it was this thing where she was having to prove herself. Whereas male directors walk in and they could be kind of shitty, and immediately people would just sort of be like, okay, you know, there's this sort of like underlying confidence. So yeah, it's been an interesting experience, you know, just trying to break down some of those barriers and working with amazing people. Like Laura is somebody who Laura came on to Lost Girl, and I desperately needed somebody that could be on set and that understood production, but was also a writer, and that could kind of cross both sides. And we were working with a showrunner named Michael Grassi, who is an amazing man, amazing man. And our team was pretty much all women, actually.
Yeah,
it was Michael. He hired all women. You know, he's gay, and he had gone through a lot of adversity through his life, and he's just an awesome person. But we brought in Laura just because we needed somebody on set, and like, you were able to get that respect from the crew. I always admired you for that. But it's hard, you know. And I want to give a little shout out to Noreen, who was our costume designer on Dark Matter and Lost Girl, and Linda McCormack, who is our makeup artist. So we've got two production heads of like two of the hugest, you know, parts of the job, like. And they, you know, they run those, like, they run their teams so amazingly, and they're kind of like, you know, they kind of kept the crew together, and, you know, they're both women, and they have so much respect for the crew. Like, people don't mess with Noreen and Linda, so, you know.
No, seriously, try it.
Yeah. No. So yeah, so it's interesting, but you do constantly get that kind of thing too, you know, where even like the network is kind of pushing back on you, and as a producer, I just you know, one of the things that I do is just like, you know what, I'm going to push hard to make sure that we've got a room that's diverse, that's got women, you know, that's got all representations, especially depending on what the, you know, you've got some shows where like the subject matter, you're going, really? You've got a room of like all white men doing this show? This is crazy. So, you know, there's a lot of programs coming in Canada now to like ensure that that's not happening. And I think we are making strides, but you know, as we've all seen the past couple months in Hollywood and here, like it's the same. Like Laura and I had coffee the other week and we were just saying like, when's it going to start happening here? Like there is still this echelon of powerful men who, you know, have been able to get away with stuff that
I feel like, you know, in my experience, a lot of the time as a woman, as a showrunner, as a director, men have, you know, said things, treated me in certain ways, and I've eaten it. And I've just, you know, oh, okay, and I'll pretend I didn't understand what they were really saying and putting me down in whatever way. And there have been times where I haven't taken it and said, like, this is bullshit, but a lot of the time I don't wanna go there, like, whatever, it's fine, peace, stay peace. And I do feel like a lot of women who I'm talking to, that's enough. I do feel like we're standing up for ourselves more. And it's like, you know what? That's not appropriate. You can't treat us like that. And there's just an assumption when a woman director comes on set that it's like, have you ever done this before? Like, what? You know? But, you know, or as a showrunner, that your choices are not necessarily the right ones and questioned. And you know, you're like, okay, and you answer their questions. And whereas I feel like any showrunner that I've learned from who are male do not answer those questions. They tell the person to fuck off. And not that I want to tell anyone to fuck off, like I'm not, but fuck off.
I think, you know, everything that's been said, I can echo to some degree. And I can't help, though, when I'm listening to all of this, think about just this notion of being really careful not to fall into sort of us and them a little bit. And I think I always try to remind myself, men are not inherently bad. Like, there isn't, like, bad men and good women. That isn't a thing. It's a whole society that we're in that has brought us to where we are. And it's a combination of so many complicated things. So I'm very careful not to kind of fall into just this us and them sort of dynamic, because I don't think it ultimately works anytime you're in an us, you know, me and you, me against you kind of thing. And I think that most men that I talk to, if made conscious or aware of something, for the most part, are open and willing to at very least the conversation. I don't think that anybody walks in and goes, I'm going to be an asshole today. Like, I don't think that's something people do. I don't think that. Maybe I'm wrong, but I don't think that people are doing that. In the same way that I need to be aware of my privilege as a white person all the time, I have to be aware of that. It's no different. How I communicate, how I walk through the world, the way that I relate to people, the things I take for granted as a white person, that I never think about what it's like to not be a white person, looking at a sea of white dolls in a toy store. And I never have to think about that, because it's just my life. Men are no different in that they are living their life in the way that they have had a pile of privilege that they now have to, we're saying, you need to think about this. You need to really think about it. And the Me Too movement, I think, has happened not out of nowhere. Not all of a sudden people went, hey, I'm gonna stand. It's because it's been slowly built from a lot of really courageous people who have done little things along the way that have made it so that we can stand up finally and go, you know, asking me to do that in an audition isn't appropriate. Whereas, you know, certainly when I first came out of theater school, there were times where I was like, boy, this feels weird. I don't know if this is cool. But you do it because you're just out of theater school and you want a part and you don't know how to say no to a director who has a list of credits. And they're not even maybe aware, maybe they are. The question that they're, the thing that they're asking you to do is so unbelievably uncomfortable for you. And it's just, I think, now about all of us being aware, being more aware than we've been before, and demanding
to be in a room and go, I'm not okay with this. And I think the thing I notice on set more than anything is just how long it takes to be heard as a female. That's something that, you know, I constantly am going, hang on, I have a point to make, hang on, I have a point to make, hang on, and then finally on my fourth time, my point is heard. You know, that's something that I've noticed on sets where I've been in a room full of guys. And I think partly it's like guys have louder voices and they're you know, it's, and you do sometimes have to fight through that noise to go, hang on, I'm trying to say something. I guess all I'm, my point is, and it's a little all over the place right now, but I'm just mindful of being, of not getting into, you know, bad guys, good girls. Because I think in the same way, it's not bad white people, good non-white people. It's like it's about, I think, bringing an awareness now. We have a responsibility to be more aware of what's going on, of our own privilege, of our own behavior, and its effects on other people. That's two cents.
I second that. I think it's actually really, I forget who I was talking to, but I, like after, you know, Me Too and Time's Up is happening, it feels like for the first time in my life, a really, really exciting time, and that there might actually be real change, and not just in this industry, but in hopefully all industries. As a woman in this particular industry, yeah, I've had one experience in particular that was abusive and horrible, and I did speak up, and this was a long time ago, and nobody sided with me. I spoke to the Directors Guild of Canada, I spoke to our union, and everybody sided with the director. So I was quite hurtful very early on in my career. But I think now that behavior wouldn't be accepted, which is really exciting. I have a little anecdote talking about being a woman in this industry, and it's being this project, Ghost BFF, got into a few film festivals, but one film festival in particular. I just had a baby, and so my project happened to be going to film festivals when I was in my 8th and 9th month. And if anybody's been pregnant in your 9th month, you're actually not allowed to fly anymore. It's called your like no fly zone. So I wasn't able to attend any of these film festivals of like my baby that I've been working on for the past 3 years. And one film festival in particular, we had one meeting arranged with an executive, and I pleaded with the film festival my case. I was explaining that, you know, I live in Canada, this film festival is in the States, I won't be able to fly down, but I'd love to be able to do this meeting over Skype. And I explained, I was like, you know, I'm 9 months pregnant, I'm about to have a baby, I would be there if I could. And they flat out told me that no, they only accept people who come in person to the film festival. And I was kind of like, it was a bit of a wake-up call that, you know, our industry is saying that they want women in film, but they're not really putting, what's that saying? But like baby, right? Like money where their mouths are.
Right.
And that in that case, I feel like it's reasonable to ask for an exception because, you know, women have a different experience throughout their life. One of that, if they choose to be pregnant at one point, and some things aren't going to be as accessible. And I noticed right there where your opportunities start to ebb away, because who knows what kind of experience I would have had with that executive or at that festival. So yeah.
Now, a couple of you have touched on working in the U.S., and I believe all of you have had experience working on productions that were either co-productions or U.S. based. Friends of mine who live in the U.S. seem to think that Canada is like this magical fairyland where everyone gets along and, you know, everything is sunshine and rainbows and kittens. But I want to dispel those myths. So maybe you can just describe some of the key differences that you've found in working on productions in the U.S. versus Canada, for those of you that have.
Well, I've worked on productions here that had American networks and Canadian networks, but I've never worked in the States.
Same.
Yeah. Okay. So a lot of the stuff, just like to familiar as everyone. A lot of the stuff that is like a US-based show actually shoots in Canada now because it's so much cheaper. So a lot of the stuff we do, it would be like a US show, but it's shooting in Canada. I don't know if you were there at San Diego Comic Con. So there's these big like fan events people don't know called like the Comic Cons. And San Diego is particularly busy and hectic and crazy, and I don't love crowds. And so like, as a producer going down to it, you kind of have to go because it's an honor to be asked to come, and you do the autographs and da-da-da. But like for me, it's like 3 days of just like pure hell. And like you just like the energy of like so many people like crammed into a city, I just like couldn't handle it. Anyway, so Guillermo was down for the strain, and he's like a big deal, right? He just like won a Golden Globe, and everybody like respects him so much. And I was just like in a different place in my head, and I was trying to get to one of our actors from Dark Matter. Maybe you were there, yeah. And I was just like really annoyed. It was Roger, and he's like, oh, Mr. Talk, he's talking to everyone. And so, anyways, I thought Guillermo was a security guard, and I was like, can you just move? I need to get to my actor. I just have to tell him that his wife is trying to get to this. And like, I see Roger's face just go white, and I'm like, what, Roger? And he's like, Vanessa, yes, Guillermo, this was my producer, Vanessa. I was just telling you about this great producer I'm working with. Vanessa, this is Guillermo. And he's like, don't worry. You probably thought I was Michael Moore. It's okay. I was just like, mortified. But yeah, I basically like, pushed him over. I was just like, get out of my way. So yeah. But anyway, yes, he does a lot of stuff here.
Yes. I know you've worked on projects that originated with Canadian networks and then were acquired by US networks. So were there any kind of hurdles initially with like, from what I understand, things are a little more open and there's some more freedoms here with what you can show on television changing, but
sure, yeah.
What were some of those challenges like bringing Lost Girl?
Yeah, Lost Girl was definitely a bit more challenging for those of you who haven't seen it. It was a pretty racy show. It was like definitely like ahead of its time. There was quite a bit of nudity, and yeah, we did end up having to cut a lot of the nudity out for the U.S. network, which was a cable network.
There was no real nudity. It was just like bits of.
So we had to do a lot of the nudity.
No, but like it was never
nudity. It was pretty blood. Yeah.
Yeah. It was like, but like shots, like you know.
Yeah.
You never saw.
Well, we had to cut a lot of it out. Like, you'd get, like, notes from the U.S. broadcaster just kind of being like, hey, can you take that out? Or with swear words and stuff, like, with the cable networks here, you can kind of say certain things, and there they'd be, like, changing it to, like, fork this. And you're like, seriously, you guys just, why didn't you just ask us to change it? And so that was, like, they got someone to...
The best thing was in the AD trailer, there was a page up on the bulletin board with a list of words that you couldn't say.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
It was the best list.
Yeah, it was, like, crazy.
I'd just go in there if I had a bad day and look at the list.
Yeah, I think I finally one day just like asked the network exec, I put a list together of the words you don't like, and it was like super awkward for me.
Oh my god,
it was, like,
amazing.
Okay, but it was like
words. I was like, I've never said that word. Yeah. Like, what is that word?
Yeah. I was I did a show called The LA Complex, and it always the pilot of that show in Canada. It was not leaked out, but the actress, the main character, took the morning after pill, and on the CW, they bleeped that out.
Oh, wow.
They bleeped out the morning after pill, and I think...
Oh, the word they bleeped out?
Yeah, the word. And I think Kate was a writer on it with me. Did she say abortion?
Oh, I don't think so.
No. But anyway, morning after pill bleeped out, and not here, so I mean... Yeah. Oh, and then science. Well, that's a whole other thing.
You couldn't say
science. No. Well, we did. We had. We wrote a whole storyline that was about a character who joined Scientology, and it was a long time. We were like, we're actually doing this. We're doing this. And then, like 2 weeks before, they said, no, you can't do that. And then we ended up changing it to
Cyanetics.
Cyanetics. Yeah.
Okay.
Anyway. Yeah, and so no one knew.
Just to shift gears a little bit, Zoe, your job as an actor, I'm assuming, has changed quite a bit over the years. Now we are in an age of after shows, year-round fan engagement, social media. So how specifically has your job changed besides just showing up, acting, and going home at the end of the day, that which is how I'm guessing it used to be at one point in time.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. There's a little bit, I guess, of an expectation that to use your social media to participate in the promotion of a show, I think. But not heavy-handed expectation. Like, I've never felt that I, you know, you kind of are asked occasionally to live tweet, or you're asked to, you know, if there's a premiere of a show, to sort of, you know, be a part of that. And but it's never been in a way that has felt like I couldn't say no. I've never felt that.
You're kind of not the norm, though. You're very, like, I would say you are very, you know, one thing I've always admired about you is when you don't want to do something, you're like, you know what, I'm actually, that's a boundary, and I'm just going to not do it. Whereas I feel like, yeah, I feel like probably a lot of people, almost a lot of companies too are like, well, hey, if we put billboards up, it's going to cost us a lot of money, so let's just get our actors to do
right.
it all. For, you know, I think there is, like, definitely a bit more expectation, and I think so probably some, like, maybe newer actors would maybe feel
yeah.
more like, they have, or like, or someone like Amanda who just, like, totally takes it on and loves it, or,
right.
you know?
Yep.
Yeah. Or like, like, go to the cons and make thousands and thousands of dollars.
Right. I don't know. yeah. Gosh, I don't know. I haven't really noticed a significant change, really, in my experience with respect to that, other than I use it, you know, to some degree to either promote the show or sometimes causes that I'm personally attached to, for sure. I'll use it in that way, you know, be it, you know, I do a thing with Missing Children, so I use Twitter for that. And, but yeah, I don't know. Do you have anything that I haven't said?
No.
Tell me.
I like to tweet
yeah.
about the stuff I'm in and Instagram about it, but yeah, nobody explicitly asks me to do that.
Oh, I've been asked.
Yeah,
sure.
Yeah.
Like I've definitely been asked. I guess the other thing I've noticed is that you're just more accessible.
Mm, yeah.
Like people can.
Yeah.
Get to you.
Yeah.
If
okay.
they want. And so you know that sometimes can be. You know.
Can I say something as a creator? I wish our actors did more. Like on our shows, I wish that they. Were, I mean, I know, you know, American shows, their actors, they think a lot of American actors tend to, like, live tweet during the show. Like, it's quite big. And on my shows, I wish that they could do more. I wish that we could promote more and be a little bit louder in promoting our shows. Just because I'm really proud of them. And no one cares about me doing it. It's the actors that they want to hear. So I've never asked the actors, but I just wish that they would.
Do you think that's an initiative that would be at a TV network level or at a production company
yes.
level?
Yes.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, I always just feel like with anything like that, I'm probably like more hypersensitive. I don't like asking people to do things that like they're not being specifically paid for and that
yes.
kind of thing. Like, I like to like really keep like rules. You know, this is what you're doing. You're being paid to do this and. They don't like to ask too many favors, but I mean, some people will overwork.
Yes.
Like some actors, you're like, oh my God, can you stop? Like, calm down. Like the fourth wall is gone. We know like way too much about you, and nobody's even thinking about your character anymore. They're just like, so I think there is like this kind of a happy medium.
I think it's got to be a support to a show. Like I don't think that I could ever tweet a show to get an audience to watch it that wasn't a show that audiences wanted to watch.
Sure.
Like I don't think. It would be powerful enough that it would, if something was a terrible show and no one wanted to watch it, that no amount of tweets that I could tweet will ever
sure.
change that.
But I do love when we live tweet together.
Sure,
it's fun.
There's
an engagement with
community.
The audience.
Yeah,
yeah like it's just it's fantastic. You know, on Mary Kills People, they do that, and it's nice. I wish we did it more. I feel like as an audience member and a fan of TV. I love it when actors are tweeting along the shows that I'm watching with them. I just like it. So
I love live tweeting Shadowhunters. Like when it's happening because the fans are so engaged that it's highly enjoyable. Yeah.
No,
Now, Zoe, you had mentioned using your social media presence for good and promoting causes that you believe in. That kind of segues to Vanessa, a project you're working on right now, Vanessa Matsui, this web series that you've discussed, Ghost BFF, which I had a chance to watch just like this little trailer of it, and by the it's haunting me. So maybe you can talk a little bit about that project and what it is at the heart of it that is being discussed, because I think it has a super powerful message.
Thank you. So Ghost BFF is about two best friends, but one is dead, and the dead girl died because she killed herself. And it's loosely inspired by my own best friend when she was suffering from depression. And so the show, I mean, okay, it's a comedy, just to let you know. It's, but it does, yeah, we discuss depression and mental health in young women. But I always feel like my background is an improviser and a comedian, and I think that the best way to talk about these really tough topics is through comedy. We've partnered with the Center for Mindfulness Studies that's based in Parkdale, Toronto, and they work with a lot of challenging populations dealing with mental health, because in Canada, as with most countries in the world, there's really a two-tiered approach to mental health, and that is people who have money and people who don't. And if you don't have money and you suffer from depression, it's a huge challenge. And mindfulness practice is an evidence-based, cost-effective way to deal with depression. As long as you're not suicidal, at that point you do need intervention, but if you're at the beginning stages. So this center offers tools to help you deal with it. We definitely want to open the conversation about mental health and depression in young women.
Apparently the rates are exponentially up.
Yeah, it's
killer.
Exactly. Well, it was something that my co-writer, Katie Nolan, who's in the house, we had done a lot of research and talked a lot about it, but there is definitely this gap in kind of your 20s where you're no longer under your parents' insurance program, but you don't have a job yet necessarily that would cover like traditional mental health help. And I think for sure people are falling through the cracks. I mean, therapy is really expensive. Like, that's like, you know, in some places it's like $200 an hour in Toronto.
So let's lift things up a little bit. I think we've hit some of the hard topics right off the bat. But obviously there is something about this industry that all of you love. You love being a part of it. I don't think you would be in it if you didn't love it. So maybe you can talk about some of the positive aspects of the industry and why it is that you are drawn to it and continue with it. But also, if you've noticed kind of a shift from a past that was highly competitive and in some cases, you know, not the most encouraging environments in the past, if you're finding it shifting to a collaborative style of projects that are coming up now.
Well, I work in writers' rooms, which are incredibly collaborative. Always, that's why I love being in writers' rooms. I love writing. I hate writing, but I love being in a writer's room. I love collaborating. I love breaking story with a group of people. I love being on set and collaborating with crew and getting ideas from wardrobe and actors and makeup and lighting and all of it. It's such a collaborative experience. I think I, as a writer, love making television and film because it's so collaborative. As a writer, it's so isolating when you actually have to go and write, and I hate it.
And so it's so refreshing to be with people and be able to express what you're going through. You know, in a writer's room, we, you know, the topics that we tackle are things that we are experiencing in our lives, we're fighting with, we're, you know, trying to understand. So it's so nice to talk with other people and get other people's opinions and voices, and I just love the industry because of that.
Yeah, and I mean, it's just like you're constantly, I mean, why I love it, you're constantly meeting amazing people who you end up like being friends with. It's just there are so many creative, awesome people who you get to collaborate on a project, and like when a show is actually in production, there's like kind of like 250 people there, and there's all these different departments, and it's kind of crazy to think that like if one thing went wrong, everything would go down, but it never does. Like, sure, there's always like you learn the longer you've been in the industry, and like I remember the first show I produced or whatever, you know, you're just like terrified, like, oh my god, there's a problem and it's like the show's gonna go down, and then you get to a point where you're like, you know, you kind of just, you know, like you're gonna solve it. It's gonna somehow work out, and it always does, and all these people kind of come together and they're all doing their individual jobs, but without each department, I feel like each department is respected as much. So like every department is its own craft, and that's what's so nice about the industry. It's not like, I mean, sure, there's always hierarchies that like, you know, we want to get rid of, but everybody is respected. Every job is so important. So I think that's kind of an awesome thing. Like, people really come together and, you know, make this amazing product that you see at the end that you're like, wow, we all just did that. And it seemed like it was so daunting at the beginning, and then you kind of get through it. And yeah, and you just collaborate with such great people that end up being kind of like lifelong friends a lot of the time.
Totally. Yeah. No, I mean, I think what I reminded of when I'm on set is, you know, oftentimes actors are treated in a certain way that is different from other departments. And it's never lost on me that, like, I cannot do what I do without literally every other department. Like, you take any one of those departments away, any one of them, doesn't matter, pick one, doesn't matter. I can't do what I do. Like, I can't do it without Linda, I can't do it without Maureen. Like, I won't have any clothes to wear, and I'll look terrible. And there's a lighting department, I can't do it without lights. I can't do it without any department. There's something really special. I've always really loved being part of a team. There's something about being part of a team that I just love. And set is it is a team. And it's just a really cool, I always feel honored to be a part of that team, because it's really special. It really is. And everybody's so incredibly talented. Even on theater, I don't do much theater anymore, but similarly, it's just, you know, it really is like everyone's moving together, and you're kind of in this situation that, you know, you just have to be, you have to be all talking together, you have to be working together, and then sometimes something really beautiful comes from that. It's really special.
Yeah, I love acting. I think there's nothing quite like it. It's more real than real life in this weird way, like when you're with a really good actor, and it doesn't even really have to be a really good actor. You can and you know, you can just have this connection sometimes, and it's very intimate and exciting. And you can sometimes, you know, you go home afterwards and you're like, what just happened? Like, it's very invigorating. You know, like, it's not coincidental that sometimes like actors fall in love on set, because it's like there's so much love. And I think it's sometimes a myth about the competitiveness, because like I find actresses are actually like some of my best friends. They're some of the loveliest people in my life who are incredibly supportive of each other, and are always good to talk to when you've had a bad day. And I also love creating my own projects. Like after shooting Ghost BFF, like after getting the final cut, there was nothing. It felt so good. Yeah, to have this thing that you just made, like it's different than making babies. It's like it's
a little bit,
because you needed more people, and I love the craft. Sometimes the industry's shit, but the craft is. And the people in it are actually quite beautiful, like as you've seen on this panel.
Yeah. Well, ironically too, so much of acting anyway is done on your own, like before you get to do it. There's so much kind of unwriting, I can't even imagine. Like it's all on your own, I guess, in a lot of ways, right? Like you're, you know, just coming up with ideas and all of that is, I would be
dead.
But with acting, you do, you sit in your room or whatever with a script and you figure it out, you break it down and you walk around your house like a lunatic saying out loud and hope that no one is home. And you know, there's so much of that part of it, but it is such a nice thing to finally actually get to do it. Because there's a lot of, I mean, you know, I imagine you talk to yourself at home a lot, right?
Constantly. Like walking down the street, yeah. I'll be doing my lines.
I think I'll do that too, guys.
Yeah.
Oh, do you do that?
Yeah.
Okay.
You like sit and like talking, or like I'll just be
going
through a scene.
Because sometimes we go,
Jesus,
did they
like,
say this out loud?
Yeah. We do. I was going to say something about the competitiveness question, part of it. I experienced competitiveness in a room once, just once, and it was unfortunately with another woman, and it broke my heart. It was just one experience, and it was, I was a baby writer at the time, and I didn't know how to navigate it, and it was really heartbreaking. But the thing I learned from that was to keep, when you work with good people, keep them close, and keep working with them, and that's the thing I learned from that, because life's too short. And if you can work with the people that you love, then work with them.
Not you, Kate, not you. Lara, you've talked a lot about being in a writer's room and writing and producing. You've also directed as well. But Vanessa, you're a producer in a very different kind of way. So maybe you can talk a little bit about what it means to be a non-writing producer.
So it is interesting because a lot of the time people will be like, what do you do for a living? And sometimes like, I just want to say I'm a lawyer because it's like so confusing to explain. But there's a lot of different types of producers, and in film and in television, different types of producers mean different things, so it is very confusing. But like, Lara is a producer and a writer, and often as a writer, once you're more senior, you would fall into producer roles as well, whether it's something where you're on set or, because kind of like, well, like the type of producing I do is like I develop shows, so somebody like any of these women might come to me and be like, hey, I have this idea, and either like I've written a pilot or I have a concept, and then we would sort of work together and like we would kind of develop it a bit more, and then I would do a lot of the like sales. So I'd be like, hey, Lara, let's take this to CTV, and then we would go together and we would pitch to the network. So it is a big collaboration. These two, I mean, right now, Lara and I are going like in the next couple weeks to pitch some stuff. So, but you know, an actor, a writer, a director might come to me with something, and then we take it sort of from a concept, and then we try and pitch it out and sell it, and then take it to production, and then once it's greenlit, so once you have all your financing together, so like my job would kind of be like creative plus putting together the financing, making sure we have enough money to actually do the thing, making the sales to different territories, and then once it's greenlit, we do the casting and hiring all the different production teams, and we would do that kind of together. So like you would do that with the person that you're developing with. So it's kind of fun because you get to work with awesome people who, if you believe in their idea, you believe in their idea enough to help get it made, I guess. So yeah, but I don't do any writing, and
did stunts once.
Why didn't you hear more about this?
I didn't really.
Didn't you do one little stunt?
No, I didn't. I like lent my car and it just ended up in my IMDb. But yeah, so yeah, I mean it's about supporting the creative team in a way, and like kind of you're almost like a project manager in a way. Like if you were building a home, you're kind of like, okay, let's make sure that everything's going well and we're hiring all the best people, and A lot of it's about like also trusting those people. So if you believe in someone, you like let them do it and you don't micromanage it. And I think that's a really important thing about producing is, you know, to make people feel safe and to make the best product, but to like support your creative team. And you might have to go to battle with the network sometimes, and there's just like that happy, that balance, right? Where you don't want to be fighting against your creative team. You want to be kind of making everybody happy and making the best product.
So we're going to take some audience questions now, and then before we wrap, I'm going to come back. I'll have one final question for the ladies. So if you have a question, raise your hand.
I can bring the mic to
Okay,
that.
Great.
Speaking of the future of the industry, for any young women who are, or not even young women, but women who are getting into the industry that you are, what are some practical ways that they can actually speak up about inappropriate actions or things that happen to them with respect to Me Too and everything that has happened? How confident do you think people can be to speak up?
I mean, I know in the DGC, there's been a lot of effort in the union, the Directors Guild of Canada, to the union has just did, you know, during the Christmas break, talks with people, any women or men who they wanted to speak. I mean, it's a very safe time right now.
Okay.
I think people are listening. I, as I was saying earlier, as a writer in the past and a director in the past, I have felt many times where I couldn't speak because I was just the same. I thought it was okay. I wanted to be part of the, that's fine. I was complicit in many ways myself because I didn't necessarily know that that was inappropriate, but I feel like I've been woke a little bit, and it's safe. You can say, it's okay to say, this boys club is a boys club. And, you know,
do you feel that people know this? Do you feel that people are aware?
As Zoe was saying, like, I don't think necessarily they even know a lot of the time. I mean, I think it's just has been a culture. You know, I've been in writing rooms. I was telling Lauren, who's another writer over there, I've been in writing rooms where, you know, let's watch some porn, and I'm the only woman in the room. And then you're pitching something, and then they'll turn the thing while you're pitching, and you see, and it's a joke, and then at the end of the day, they're like, I'm so sorry if that offended you. I'm like, no, that's totally cool, whatever.
Yeah.
I'm cool. I don't have a problem with that. Now, I feel like if that were to ever happen, I do feel like it's a safe place to say, guys, I don't, like, can you work? I'd really like to just work and not do this. And I don't think that they did it to all of them. They didn't do it just to me, they did do it to the other men as well.
Do you think women who are in the industry are aware that it feels like the safe space?
I think so.
I think so now.
I think right now, and that's why I say right now. Right now, it feels like we can speak up and be listened to.
Well, I think you know, fear is a big motivator, and I think that I imagine there are a lot of people that are very afraid of their own behavior, probably. And we're in a particularly, I mean, this particular time in history. I mean, literally right now, you know, I think people are doing nothing that they think would be offensive on any level. That's not to say that it isn't really important to still put steps in place.
Yeah.
Because this time right now is like a bushfire, right? It's happened and it's crazy and people are terrified to say anything in jest for fear. It's taking it in the wrong way right now. Like, that's where we are at the moment, which is great, I think. You know, I think we had to go to this place. We had to overshoot like crazy to hopefully get to a place where now we can look at this with a little perspective, and we can have actual steps in place for people, be it in auditions, be it in writers' rooms, be it on set, where when A happens, you do B now. So that it isn't just, I feel weird, and do I say it in front of everyone, I feel weird, and now it's an awkward moment on set? Is that the new
And
answer?
It's such a
hard industry too, because it's like creative, right? So there's a lot of moments where, you know,
there is a fine line. So
yeah,
yes.
And there might be, you know, there might be a male director where a female actress doesn't feel totally comfortable, and they're kind of going like, but am I supposed to be doing this? Did I agree to this? And did I do that? And, you know, I think everything that's been happening at the Golden Globes and everyone, you know, wearing black and all that, that's like a great statement. I think we just have to make sure that we're putting into place ways to make sure though that like people here are like are feeling safe and being okay, because as a female producer, I've been like hypersensitive to always making sure that female cast particularly feel comfortable during like, you know, shows where you're doing lots of nudity and sex scenes and stuff like that, where you're like, I would, you know, have the directors write the scene out before, we'd go over it, the actor would read everything that was gonna happen, they would have a conversation, and still, on set sometimes, you know, I'd make sure to be there and just be like, is everything cool? Because you just, there's, you know, there's just moments where someone might not feel great, and I've definitely had actresses.
Everyone has a different threshold,
you know?
For where they feel uncomfortable. And there are times on set, too, where you just, things are getting carried away, because you're doing a scene, and it's a crazy scene, and it's, maybe it's a sex scene, maybe it's a stunt. It often happens in stunts. It's another great comparison where you're doing a stunt and they're like, let's do it again, let's do it again, let's do it again. And, you know, you as the person who's doing it is like, I don't know if I can do it. Okay, yeah, let's do it again, let's totally do that again. You know, and it's happening and you're just saying yes because you're like, you don't want to go, guys, I'm really, like, I've hurt myself last take and I don't want to do this again. And, you know, it's all of those scenarios are just things that we have to have something in place so that you're not left to scramble to figure out how to handle a moment. It's handled for you. This is what happens when this happens. That's what I think we have to work on, is like, what do you do when? As opposed to the person in the moment trying to figure it out on their feet in the sort of adrenaline of shooting a scene or shooting a stunt, because it does get, you know, people do get carried away. The director, and it's not because the director's an awful person, it's because sometimes it's because you're just in the middle of a crazy situation with a lot of bells and whistles, and you know, sometimes things happen that shouldn't in all of that chaos. And so it's about figuring out, how do we have organized chaos? What do we do?
At the end of the day, I mean, it's a creative industry, but it's a job. Mm-hmm. It's work. And there, you know, there are things that are inappropriate to do at work and unsafe. And I think we've all just been a part of this thing. It's like, it's cool, and now it's
Oh, I've definitely done it's cool. Yeah. I've absolutely done things on set where I've been like, oh, okay, I don't want to do this, but I'm gonna.
It's a job, and you shouldn't. You know?
That is why the unions are great, right? Having the unions, even to overwork people. If you're on a non-unionized show, you could be like, I'm gonna work you 16 hours.
The difficulty
like,
is, what if one take is too much for one actor, and 10 takes is too much for another, right? And so, therein lies a bit of a problem, right? Because if one actor does a take and goes, listen, I'm just tired now, and you're like, oh, I guess we have to respect that. You know what I mean? That's where, but there are those examples that need to be sort of, in an effort to really look at the whole and go, like, things shouldn't happen on set. Totally. They shouldn't.
Yeah.
But also, there are scenarios where it's a fine line, it's a gray area, it's not black and white.
100%. That must be so difficult to navigate, though.
It is.
I mean, for someone who is
seasoned,
of course. Then you have someone who is just getting into it. That must be so difficult.
Right, and that's
and
why
I
say it's complicated.
Yeah,
and it isn't just like, listen, it's inappropriate. There's more than that to talk about.
I'm quite curious about two things. The first part of my question concerns pay gap. Quite frankly, a lot of us, as we get, not only when we're young, but as we get older and we get more accomplished, our concerns are about a pay gap. Are we being reimbursed for the same number of hours or the same amount of work as our counterpart would be if they were male? So I'm curious to see or hear from you in terms of what you see. The second part of the same question is, what are your concerns about pay gap? Do you believe that as women we have a competitive advantage, or you can use a competitive advantage, that we're a little bit cheaper and therefore get more opportunities? Just putting it out there.
I would say in my experience, I haven't really experienced that in terms of, I mean, a lot of the time, like, you know, I'm on the other side of it, but in terms of like a lot of the female showrunners I've worked with are being paid very competitively compared to male showrunners in Canada.
You're unique though, you're a particular
Yeah, see, I only know what I pay people, so I don't know. I don't necessarily know. Like, it would probably be better to hear from your guys' experience.
Well, you know, you just are particularly good in that department, I guess, for lack of a better way to put it. But you are, you know, I mean, you that's important to you that you're mindful of that stuff. So, if I can speak on your behalf.
Yeah, thank you.
To be perfectly honest, I don't know. I don't know.
Yeah, same here. I have no idea.
I feel like I was actually just having this conversation. I want to be more open about that because I don't know.
I think in Hollywood for sure.
Yeah.
Right? Like
yeah.
There's so much of that where it's like the male leading person in a movie is making so much more than the female. I don't think it's as bad in Canada.
I've never felt like I've been underpaid, but I have had conversations where people have said that I'm underselling myself, or if I was a man, I would have asked for twice, or something, you know, those kind of things. But
for sure, yeah.
But I'm never great. I don't know.
Let me ask a different question. Do you know how much a person of equivalent experience?
Yes.
And so you all know that.
No, I don't.
Ends up being a little bit transparent in some ways in our industry. I mean, I think just because like these budgets kind of go from department to department, and there's lots of stuff that can be hidden, but like I think in terms of what I see on paper when I'm dealing with, for sure there is kind of a thing where networks often there is this weird undertone of like, oh, you're gonna put so-and-so Mr. Whoever on the show, now I feel more safe, like versus like a female writer. But there's so many shows right now that are being in Canada, they're being led by female writers. So I'm sure there is still some of that. I mean, in terms of actors, I think for me, whenever I feel like I've sort of overpaid an actor, is usually because there's a competing show that they're on, something happens where there's a crazy negotiation and it has nothing to do with the fact that they're male or female. It's like, this show just offered them X and now I really want them, and that's what's happening. And that's the only time that I feel like I've ever sort of overpaid is based on how busy they are. But I'm sure there's a lot of cases, probably more, I mean, I think more in like the acting and writing department where, you know, there might be that case where like, you know, and maybe less so now.
Yeah.
I think so.
I've
you know, but I think, yeah, I'm sure there is a bit of an undercurrent of it.
I think once you get out of, I mean, you know, there's our union that you get paid a certain amount no matter what. Right?
Yeah.
Like as an actor, you get paid a certain amount no matter what. And then after that, you're in negotiations. Your agent negotiates with the production company and you figure out an amount. And for sure, I think as a female, there is, you know, and of course I have male friend actors, so you know this just based on conversations about, you know, you're doing a guest star. And again, it's you know, I really want to say that it really is you excluded in this, because this has never been the case with you. I think that you're very good at it. But yeah, I think, you know, and it's a little bit like being heard with your voice being heard. It's like you have to fight a little harder. You know, it'll be a given that so-and-so would make X as a guest star on this show. I would have to fight a little harder for X.
We've got one final question just at the back here.
Yeah.
I'm just going to ask you to be short, sorry.
Thank you. Hi. I'm fairly new in Toronto, and it's coinciding with the creation of two shows, or pushing two shows that are created a little harder. So I would like to ask what tips, in case there are other people who are creating shows, what tips you would give for people to approach people like you who have been in the industry for more time. You can take yourself as examples, or maybe people who have similar roles.
I would say doing programs, like I don't know if you're a writer or a producer or a director, but I think like definitely in Canada, doing any kind of program, like going to like the Canada Film Center and that kind of stuff can really kind of set you apart. It's really competitive, even here, to get yourself heard. There's a lot of awesome writers out there that just don't even get the chance because it's just so competitive. So yeah, I think doing anything you can to kind of, you know, get your stuff out there as much as you can, but like, yeah, any of those kind of like grants or funds or things that you can do that you have access to in Canada that maybe there's not as much in the States, to try and like get involved in the industry in ways that there's lots of programs, you know, that the government supports. I think that's helpful to sort of get yourself up there. I mean, it's just hard. It's just kind of like a lot of people just, you know, they start in it.
In some ways, it's incredibly hard, but it's also easier now almost than it's ever been insofar as you could just shoot something.
Yeah.
Like people do that now and it works sometimes. Like it's, you know, it's
comfortable with events like that, for example, to be approached, or is it just you do your panel and...
I will tell you, when people email me, I'll watch their reel. I say these things at panels and then I get 100 emails. But I was the same. Starting out, I made a short film, got some attention. I mean, as a writer, the best advice is to just write and just keep writing scripts. But, you know, go and meet people, email them, and send them your stuff. Maybe they won't see it, maybe they will. Shadow, if you're a director, you know, or even a writer, go shadow on sets. Call uni, just try to be involved, and that's what I did.
You gotta get face to face. I find that too. Just like even as a producer, if I'm trying to pitch to like networks in the States where it's like so competitive, even like if they like see my resume and they know I have a studio deal with E1 and stuff, if I just email a project, they're so much more likely just to say no. If I go down and they meet me face to face and there's like that human connection, it's just like, it's harder to say no, or they might just like listen a bit more versus like, we all get hundreds of things a day where, no, not hundreds, but you know, you get a lot a day where you might just kind of go like, I don't know, I don't really have time. So it's, yeah, somehow getting those face to face things. So doing things like this, going to workshops, trying to just like, you know, get as involved as you can. It's hard. I mean, my brother is trying to get into writing right now, and like, you know, there's only so much I can do to help him out. Like he's 33 and he's been writing tons of scripts and he's been working on shows as an assistant and just trying to get in there. And it's, you know, I've watched him sort of, I've been in the industry for so long that I like forget what it was like to, you know, to have to, you know, but I'm watching his struggle. It's yeah, you gotta really sort of fight for it, and yeah, get your stuff out there because you can now, as much as you can, and just kind of keep collaborating with people. And you know, my brother does a lot of that too, where he like, you know, joins groups with like other writers and they get their stuff out there, and some of them are working on shows, and so it's a community. You can kind of get your, you know.
Thank you so much to all of the panelists. Before we go, I want to invite Joanne.